is like genuine.
And when I say genuine, this time I really mean genuine.
No, I just really mean genuine pleasure and honor to introduce our next speaker. Ambassador Benny Wadiono really needs no introduction in some of the most important circles in Cambodia and in the world. But I will make an introduction to him. He's a PhD, he has a PhD in economics, and is currently a professor at Stanford University, or University of Connecticut at Stanford. But between his PhD and his current professorship, Ambassador Wadiono had a distinguished career in the United Nations. And for our purpose, I can't go into the details of what he's done over the years, we know him primarily through the work that he's done in Cambodia. And in addition to being an invaluable and key member of the CKS board of directors, before that, Ambassador Wadiono was a part of the UNTAC operation here in Cambodia, where he was made, so what they did there is they had shadow governors. UN appointed shadow governors to various provincial governors in Cambodia, and Ambassador Wadiono was the UN appointed governor of Siem Reap. After the UNTAC period, he went back to the UN, I guess, and then came back to Cambodia as the UN ambassador to Cambodia. Ambassador Wadiono has run in some very, very important circles in Cambodia, including with Lord Hun Sihanouk and the extended family. And he's also an honorary Cornellian, because the book that you read was composed and written during a two-year fellowship in Ithaca. And I could go on and on, but I won't, because you should listen to him and not to me. It is my genuine pleasure, honor, and privilege to introduce somebody who I consider a very, very good friend, and I hope it's mutual. But somebody who I consider a very, very good friend, and a wonderful scholar, and a key person in diplomacy in the region going back a generation. Please welcome Ambassador Benny Wadiono.
Thank you, Andrew. I wish I had my spokesman like you, you know. I was very happy when I was at Cornell. But let us start with my lecture today. I know that your course topic was the Chinese Empire and Cambodia. But the Chinese Empire, of course, in many different forms. So I will try to bring out that concept between the two, Cambodia and China. Let's start with a scholar's high school. This is from Robert Lefebvre, with Cornelian and historian. A scholar's highest obligation, the phrase had it in 1960, was to speak truth to power. It turned out, however, that truth was relatively speaking, and a practically relative term in the Cold War era. Many Americans were sent to die by the tens of thousands, and while Asians, Latin Americans, and Africans were sentenced to death by the millions because U.S. officials disagreed with foreign leaders about what each believed was true in terms of the need for it, of their national interest. How many of you have seen this quote before? Nobody? Well, it's in front of your book. In my book. Yes.
I raised my hand then.
Yes.
I raised my hand.
Yes, because, well, I was, some people didn't like my book because of this, you know, it's like attacking the U.S. Then I Andre already said that I have my credentials of Cornell. I can prove it to you by this. There is of course something. Suddenly all these undergrads were so kind to me, they want me to buy beer for them. But I was living next door in the Telluride House. Anybody knows where the Telluride House?
Yeah.
You know? Yes, well, I was there not as a student, I was supposed to be the faculty advisor, you know, but it was so rowdy sometimes that I and when you can't play, then we join you. So this is my credentials. So I want to connect the Cornell, the Cambodian Labor Site to the one in Indonesia. Although my book is only about Cambodia, but there is in the first chapter and the second chapter, I have compared the two massacres about Indonesia. First of all, the U.S. dominated the world during the Cold War. Economic power, you know, I'm not saying politics, yeah, but economic growth, politics also, was concentrated in North and America and Western Europe and dominated by the USA. Now the yellow one is the communist world, Soviet Union, Eastern Europe and China were in isolation in the Cold War because they were not part of the GATT, World Bank and IMF and so on. Now us, the Silk Road countries in fact were integrated in the world economy. They neither managed nor controlled. We were like children, you know, in the room. You can be seen but you cannot be heard. Be heard. You shut up. So of course during the Cold War, China was both the nationalists and the communists were allied with the West to fight the Japanese occupation, which is the yellow part. So if you can see, the Japanese control only small part, but of course they were havoc in Nanjing and so on. This is not of course. The communists, as you can see, were only the 3-4 little kidneys. But lo and behold, of course, the whole communist becomes whole China becomes communist, and the nationalists fled to Taiwan, where everyone knows about it. So therefore, Mao Zedong proclaimed the PRC October 1, 1949. For the first time, China feel proud, you know, to be united and to be even though they are poor, but not to be poor, thrown around by the West all the time, you know, opium wars and also so independent China for the first time. And that's one part of the picture where this attack of the now therefore there was the US which controlled the West and everywhere because after World War II the US was around them, you know, hey, I'm the only one who makes money because the plan is finished, Europe is in shambles, and when they look around, of course third world countries are poor, they are always poor. So I'm the only one here, so I'm pretty possible. So this could be, and China of course is also at that time, where does this go forward? Yeah, it goes, and this is the UN is not here. Yeah, because it was, anyway, what I want to say is, during the Cold War, there is a struggle for hegemony. Indonesia and Cambodia become victims of the struggle for hegemony. China is here, and the US is far away. Of course, the fight was in Vietnam, and next door is Cambodia, and Indonesia is this huge thing here. So, when you look around the US, of course, there's a struggle there. The U.S. is a great thing. Southeast Asia becomes communist, and the Chinese are confident that Southeast Asia will become communist. So here is the villagers of Manisukara from Indonesia, and here is Suharno Persiano. You know, that's in those days he was very young. Well, they both liked each other. They were friends. They visited each other 5 times, and they also both had 6 wives or something. and she says that Suharno likes his wife. And, anyway, we are not about bias here. In 1955, China's Chowin Lai approved neutralism. He was approving this in Asian-African conference in Bandung. In 1955, Indonesia, Chinese troops guaranteed Indonesia and Cambodia to their neutrality. Here is Chowin Lai and here is his fellow Sihanouk and his younger year. He actually had lunch with Sihanouk and he said to him, I will guarantee you the neutrality, meaning I'm not going to help Khmerus. You see, I will promise you, you know, I don't know who paid for the lunch, I said China. So, why does it go by itself? Automatically, where is your, do you know any people? Yes. Yeah, maybe there's a direct okay. Timing or something. What? Okay. Yeah, but I have to say also something. Okay. So, okay. Who's Eisenhower, on the other hand. Yeah. Eisenhower and John Foster Dulles, who is the Secretary of State. The U.S. openly rejected the concept of neutrality in Southeast Asia in the Cold War. So, of course, this I got from Josh McDermott here, his book, so you might say, I would say, no, the U.S. is bad and China is good, they approve neutrality. No, they both adhere to the same theory. But we call it different things. Eisenhower says that neutrality in a domino theory will bring everyone to communism. Whereas with respect to the previous one, the previous.
That's coming. Slow.
No, the other one. Previous.
Yeah, but
it's
kind of slow.
Yeah.
You know, I know
So, okay. So I'm not saying that John Lai is a good guy and John Foster Dulles is a bad guy and Eisenhower. I'm saying that they adhere to the same thing. Eisenhower says because of the dominant theory and they are neutral, they all become communists. Now John Lai says because of communism is inevitable, they will all become communists. So yes. So Both were overthrown, both were neutral, both were overthrown by right-wing general. But what is the result?
Whereas in Cambodia, there's no known fellow as
not very strong. So what happened in Indonesia is Sukarno was okay. I said when this happened in Sihanouk, of course, were in Beijing, and you will tell them later. But Sukarno was under the protection of the rebels. But the rebels, the Communist Party of Indonesia, had no army. So he was there sitting at the Air Force. The Air Force is communist. And he tried to regain control by summoning General Pranoto, who was close to him, instead of to be the head of the army, instead of Sukarno Soeharto, whom he dislikes and was anti-pro-American. But Soeharto forbade Pranoto to be Sukarno. The official statement is under Sukarno wing. From this, you don't understand what the position of Sukarno. This is the defining moment in Indonesia. Sukarno is all encompassed. Nobody dares to say a word against him. But at that time, Soeharto was calculating and decided, no, he said to Pranoto, I will be the head. So that's after that, there will be the massacre. No, what happened here? Okay, Soeharto accused the Trikaya of masterminding the movement. And within days of Soeharto's takeover, the army and army affiliated spread all across the archipelago, arresting anyone who was associated with the Trikaya and its many labor and farmer organizations. In one of the worst massacres of the 20th century, several hundred thousand people were massacred, where we talked about that before. The victims were thrown into mass graves and into rivers. And there is harrowing stories of people named Jaffa, Sumatra, and Bali. So filled with bodies that the water turned red. But how many of you have heard of this massacre? Well, that shows here, this is a learning group, because many even Indonesians don't know. This is the most closely guarded secret of massacres. But this lecture is about Cambodia, not about Indonesia. Now, of course, we know about this. He wanted to remain neutral, as I said already, because he didn't want to be involved in the Cold War. Was fighting with South Vietnam. And this was not acceptable to the UN. And of course, I'm going to quickly because you know what they call the regime there. It's you know, parts that you, I'm sure, know everything. I will go quickly. To Eastern Cambodia, the regime trail went from north to south. But and so Nixon's, President Nixon of the USA, started bombing Eastern Cambodia. Well, you know all this. And of course, once I look at this, every day these planes, they come from the skies, you know, this crazy for Americans, you must join me to fight them. And then, the first thing is the bombing, that which has started. The second thing, of course, that Sihanouk's reaction is different from Japan. Sukarno was sitting down, you know, at the Air Force Base, controlled by the communists. Within two days, Soeharto controlled the whole thing and just killed 500,000 people. In the case of Soeharto, well, Sihanouk, you know very well, this young man is Kyo Sampan, of course. And from Beijing, Sihanouk says, you know, we fight American imperialism and so on. And that's when Khmer Rouge from 200,000. And remember what Chuan Lai said in Bandung, Indonesia? I guarantee you neutrality. But after Sihanouk embraced the Khmer Rouge, of course, China said, now I can help you. And they gave them everything they want. And of course, you know the rest. Very public record. Well, this one is, okay. The USA fully supported the Khmer Republic. That was before. So Sihanouk went to China, but in Cambodia itself, and gave full military and other assistance to what? But little is known is that it was patterned after the coup in Indonesia. So what I'm trying to say is after our coup d'etat, the U.S. could be another Indonesia. We will kill all the communists, and it will be plenty of. So I have evidence that Pol Pot, Lono's troops were trained in Indonesia very much in Greenberg. So after officially recognized the Khmer, very funny, after Khmer, the conservative returns to Suhano at Beijing, because he was, he of course and Sukarno were friends, but Lon Sihanou said, no, oh, no, you are like a, we recognize you. So this is like a big for Sihanou. Of course, Pol Pot, I have to put it, the details, not the, yeah, it's fine. There are two mistakes with the PVI, he said. One is that Indonesia has no army. The Communist Party of Indonesia has no army, not a single weapon. So the Khmer Rouge strikes would be his army, Pol Pot says. So we studied the Indonesian case very carefully. Number two, the Khmer Rouge should not align itself to Sihanou, he says, because the Indonesian party was moving at Sukarno, Sukarno, and Sukarno just kept quiet there because he was all money worked by Suharto and the whole massacre took place. So we should not rely on Sihanou. So, well, we know all this, but I still have to be there, including Vietnam. Bruce and fled to Vietnam. Now, what happened in the meantime in the Chinese Empire is the Great Cultural Revolution. Which, you know, but that happened in 66 to 60. What does it mean to our two massacres? In Indonesia, the massacre was 65. So, and cultural China was very busy with the Cultural Revolution. We started in 66. So they did not, and they could not have the Communist Party in Indonesia because they were already massacred. But of course, in Cambodia, the massacre took place of Pol Pot took place in 75, and then, of course, the revolution, Cultural Revolution, ended in 76. Well, this was already 72. The nation said we started the rapport with Mao Zedong in 1972. Mao died in 76. I was in China in 1978. I was invited there to teach the Chinese how to deal with multinational corporations. So the country has completely overhauled from Cultural Revolution. They started, you know, a Gang of Four or jail, and they want to learn about how to deal with multinational corporations. I remember very well, I was with the United Nations, we have plenty of money. I said, you know, to the Chinese who were dealing with the new economy, I said, where do you want us to take your lawyers for training? They said, Wall Street, of course. You want to learn from Wall Street. So I said, you know, do you want to go to Harvard? No, Wall Street. You know, the result is, of course, the Chinese empire becomes an economic empire. But politically, and this is important for our talk today, Jimmy Carter started relations with Deng Xiaoping in 79. Now, what happened in Cambodia in 79? Yeah. Oh, you were coming in. Yes.
The fighting ended. The Vietnamese army came in.
Yes, okay. But then, what happened in the UN? Yes.
They continued to
they continued. So that's the anomaly of the recognition of the Khmer Rouge started in, by this. So China turned economically turned into a giant through Deng Xiaoping, and I said, I teach him, well, I offer Wall Street, but as I said, I knew then and there China is going to succeed. Because I asked him. Actually, I brought a professor from Greece, you know, he's a good friend of mine to teach about transfer pricing and government modeling. And he is Constantine Weitzos. He became Minister of Finance in Greece. And he was saying, oh, I'm in China, I'm in China. Oh, national, you're going to send me messages. So the Chinese said, no, don't bring that professor. And look where Greece is now and look at where China is. So I'm not an advocate of private capitalism, but this is what they have. But of course, only that's economically. But politically, they still become friends. And that's why, well, you said, you help the Vietnamese army to let them come project from the communist regime. And then, in Phnom Penh, the People's Republic was established on Hem Songkhla, it should be in control. Hun Sen became Prime Minister. That everyone knows. But what I want to say is, but this gentleman, you would say, spearheaded by the US, China, and ASEAN. ASEAN is only six countries at that time. You know, Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, and Myanmar were not members of it. You already said, I think. Continue to recognize the government of the Sudan. This is so absurd, but this happened for 11 years. So again, I said, the US is still dominant, you know. This is still the Cold War. But the US says, well, now, with the help of China, because Deng Xiaoping and what's his face, Jimmy Carter, very close friends, and the fact that the government of Cambodia. I was stationed in New York at that time. It's ridiculous. It's still fantastic, you know, how this lobbying, you know. Actually, the lobbying I enjoyed because there were parties here. See, I don't get parties at the Helmsley Hotel in New York, you know, and to say how great this Hun Sen fellow is. And then you love to see him. That's what friends are for. But we can dance together, you know, but not sing. I was so drunk, I was singing, and I was almost killed. So. Yeah, you cannot sing. But those parties, you know, were very important for the future, so, because I was, you know, every sense I'm so many, and I was in New York seeing these P42 parties, you know, and then all the time recognizing this Prehut as the government of Cambodia. So you have to learn about that, but I tell you the story is because he thinks that's what friends are for. Well, now the Soviet Union and allies recognize the DRC 100%. So we now have two governments fighting each other. The tragedy continued for 11 years, prolonging the suffering of the Cambodian people. Because nobody, although the Soviet Union's group have a minority in the UN, the US has the majority, but still you cannot ignore the Soviet Union, you know. Remember, I said, Cold War, I'm going to hear I'm the boss, but Russia says I'm the boss, you know. So there are five bosses in New York, as you know. US, China, Russia, France, and Britain. Well, France and Britain economy now is lower than Indonesia, GDP, perfectly. Never mind, the five are still the boss that they knew. Well, China was Taiwan, you know, until 73. So, of course, we know that in order to put this model of the dress the wolf and shape sheep's clothing, or quickly put the victory over the medal, they have this siege in the cave. And two newly created resistance forces, Hun Sen Pak, which is, of course, the King's party of KPNL, and JPNLF, which is the right-wing anti-government. So now we have this, okay, now we recommend CDDK, no more Sihanouk, they said. So from 92, that's the mantra of this majority. And in the field, of course, this is, I'm a refugee. I was stationed in Thailand, and this my first impression in Cambodia was that I see these refugees coming out of the jungle of Cambodia, collapsing on the floor, and hungry and so on. Then and there, I said, it was 1979 to trust the government that it was government. I want to serve in Cambodia, but it took 11 years because of the shenanigans in Cambodia before I finally arrived in Cambodia in 1991. So, the refugees became refugee warriors because the CGDK has no territory. You know, they have been fighting Hun Sen, but they could not, occupy capital city of a province, except Bailen. Bailen is of course part of Burma. So here we have the refugee camps, which were controlled by Khmer Rouge, by KPNLF, and by Hun Sen. So they become the territory of the CGDK. And first of all, they fight Hun Sen, you know, and from the border. So they said, we have our territory, that's the border camp. And China, actually, they said, when we talk about Ho Chi Minh Trail, China, of course, then started the Deng Xiaoping Trail in, from the port of Thailand to the Cambodian border to assist the Khmer Rouge army, whereas the US and the others assist the other army. You know, so when Stephen Sowers said in the Congress, when did we give arms to the Khmer Rouge, the US said, no, we gave arms to the other party. But the three are working together, you know, Stephen Sowers. Well, yeah, no. But anyway, they were armed and trained. So in other words, the mantra is destroying himself. Let him try after. But unfortunately, today he's still there. So, is anybody here? I said, unfortunately. Any microphones here? Then finally the reconciliation started when these two, so here's the fellow.